If you would turn now in your Bibles to Paul's letter to the Romans, Romans chapter 1. We begin a series on this letter. This morning we'll be looking at just verses 1 and 2, though I'll read verses 1 through 17, which is basically the whole of Paul's introduction to the epistles. So this morning we'll focus on verses 1 and 2. Romans chapter 1, beginning at verse 1. This is the word of our God. Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God, which he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures concerning his Son, who was descended from David according to the flesh, and was declared to be the Son of God in power according to the Spirit of holiness by his resurrection from the dead. Jesus Christ, our Lord, through whom we have received grace and apostleship to bring about the obedience of faith for the sake of his name among all the nations, including you, who are called to belong to Jesus Christ. To all those in Rome who are loved by God and called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. First, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for all of you, because your faith is proclaimed in all the world. For God is my witness, whom I serve with my spirit in the gospel of his Son, that without ceasing I mention you always in my prayers, asking that somehow by God's will I may now at last succeed in coming to you. For I long to see you, that I may impart to you some spiritual gift to strengthen you, that is, that we may be mutually encouraged by each other's faith, both yours and mine. I do not want you to be unaware, brothers, that I have often intended to come to you, but thus far have been prevented, in order that I may reap some harvest among you as well as among the rest of the Gentiles. I am under obligation both to Greeks and to barbarians, both to the wise and to the foolish. So I am eager to preach the gospel to you also who are in Rome. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith for faith. As it is written, the righteous shall live by faith. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. There are times where different book writers, authors, or even composers of symphonies and so forth have that one thing that they call their climax of their career in terms of like books or even musical compositions. You can call it a magnum opus. The main thing, if anything were to be the thing that you would put forth as summarizing your work, there it is. Many see the book of Romans, Paul's letter to the Romans, as his magnum opus. As far as all of the things that we have that we know for certain with respect to the Apostle Paul, Romans is the most detailed, is the largest, and many consider it to be his magnum opus. In some respects, you can think of it as like a mini systematic theology. There is a tremendous amount of theological truth that is found in this epistle. As I mentioned, it is his largest epistle. But it is interesting because with respect to writing this particular letter, he had at that point not even visited Rome. He never visited the church, at least at that point. We don't see that take place until you get to the end of the book of Acts. So this was clearly written prior to it. One historian, interestingly enough, noted, as weird as it sounds, that there were Christians there in Rome as early as 50 AD. And of course, people wonder, well, if Paul didn't found that church and never visited, how did they get there? Well, we don't have a full and clear answer to that. But one thing that we do see is, by way of a small example, as a possibility that we can't be too dogmatic about, is that if you look at the account of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2, some of the people that were there for Pentecost, we have a list of nations. And one of the places from which some of those pilgrims are from is Rome. Whether or not they founded the church, we can't say for certain. But somehow, some way, the Christian church expanded into Rome without the Apostle Paul. Quite remarkable. Now, as to when Paul actually wrote it, it's not that difficult to piece it together. There are clues, for example, at the end of chapter 15 of Romans, as well as the beginning of chapter 16. It seems that when Paul wrote this, he was basically on his way to Jerusalem after his third missionary journey. So he was probably still in Corinth. And likely, as well, the situation in Corinth had probably resolved itself enough such that Paul was now able to write this magnum opus. He had the time to be able to do it. Now, some have asked a question as to whether or not the church in Rome is predominantly Jewish or whether it is predominantly Gentile. Because, of course, as you read through Romans, you have language that affects the Jews. You have language that affects the Gentiles. Well, it seems that most see it as a consensus that it was predominantly Gentile, but with nonetheless a significant Jewish influence in the church. As we think about Romans, as we consider this, many commentaries have been written. Many sermons have been preached on Romans. And I have to confess that for myself, Romans probably is my favorite book of the Bible, and I've waited 12 years to preach it, mostly just to hold myself back. Now, to give you an indication, for example, Martin Lloyd-Jones, when he preached through Romans, if I have the number correct, he preached 356 sermons on Romans. I'm not going to preach that many sermons. There is much to be had in this book. There are many doctrines that we find in the book of Romans that help shape our modern day systematic theologies. We who are Reformed, we who are Calvinistic in our way of thinking about salvation, look to Romans in pretty much all 5 points, and find the answer there. It is an important epistle to so many. For instance, Martin Luther, it was the expression, the part of which we read in verse 18, the question of what is the righteousness of God? For many, they just saw that as an attribute of God. But reading Augustine and his own studies, Luther came to the conclusion, he had that theological epiphany when he realized that the attribute here is not what's being described, but rather a righteousness that comes from God to those who believe. The whole book answers the question, how can sinners rightly stand before God? And some have tried to break the book apart in various ways and emphasize one area or another and think that that's the main theme. So, of course, many who are very sympathetic to the Protestant Reformation, as we are, focus so much attention on the first 4 to 5 chapters because that's where we see justification by faith alone. Others look to chapters 9 through 11 because he's really trying to deal with the question of Israel. Some look from 12 to the end of the book because we need Christian ethics. So really, what is the theme of the book of Romans? What is the overarching theme? And it is quite simple, actually. It's not that complex. The theme of the book of Romans is nothing but the gospel. From beginning to end, this book is about the gospel of Jesus Christ. This is not so much a gospel account, but rather it is a theology of the gospel, so that he writes to a church to whom he has never written, they can understand all that is involved with respect to the gospel. That's why it's imperative for us to understand. We do ourselves no favor as Reformed individuals if we focus the gospel and we focus salvation only on the matter of justification by faith alone. As true as a doctrine as that is, we make everything about justification. We might as well forget about chapter 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, and so on. The gospel is more. Salvation is more than just simply that moment in time where we come to saving faith and we're justified. As rich of a doctrine as that is. And in fact, it was that very expression, the righteousness of God, that helped Martin Luther to realize the truth of that doctrine of justification by faith alone. As we go through Romans, we need to keep our hearts and minds affixed on the truth of what the gospel is. That's what this is about. Romans is about the gospel. To give indications, even some modern-day commentators and theologians that we know of will say John Calvin. I know he's not that modern. Here's what Calvin said about this book. He said two very similar things. I'll just give you one. If we understand this epistle, we have a passage opened to us to the understanding of the whole of Scripture. J.I. Packer said this, all roads in the Bible lead to Romans, and all views afforded by the Bible are seen most clearly from Romans. And when the message of Romans gets into a person's heart, there is no telling what may happen. It's a rather interesting way to put it. This is the importance of the book of Romans. And so this morning, we're going to look at just those first two verses. This is one of the longer introductions of Paul in his epistles. It has 17 verses. We're going to spend the next few weeks, this week, the following week, and the week after that, looking at just the first seven verses. I refer you back again to Martin Lloyd-Jones. He preached a few sermons just on verse 1. Won't go that far. But nevertheless, we'll look at verses 1 and 2. Really, as we consider the fact that Romans, and especially this introduction, setting forth the theme of the gospel, it's imperative we understand that principle. So what I hope to show this morning is simply this, that the gospel of Jesus Christ is found in all of Scripture and is to be shared everywhere. The gospel of Jesus Christ is found in all of Scripture and is to be shared everywhere. We're going to look at this really under just two headings, just breaking it up, verses 1 and 2. First of all, we'll look at Christ's servant, and then secondly, we'll look at Christ's Scripture. So first of all, Christ's servant. Look again at verse 1. Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God, which he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures. Paul, the Apostle Paul, someone we are quite familiar with, otherwise known as Saul, which was probably his Jewish name, Paul being his Greek name. We're familiar with him, especially because of the book of Acts, as well as his other epistles. We even, in his epistles, scattered throughout, especially in Galatians, also in 2 Corinthians, get kind of a biographical sketch of his ministry. He was called by Christ himself on the road to Damascus. He was the persecutor of the church. He was a Jew among Jews, the Pharisee of Pharisees, and later on he describes himself near his death as the chief of sinners. One untimely born, as he puts it. Born of God, regenerated in time. He was trained in the school of Hillel, which you can look on that on Wikipedia or something. Trained by Gamaliel in his school, the same man who is mentioned in Acts. He is truly a Pharisee of Pharisees. I believe it was R.C. Sproul who mentioned that Paul had the kind of education that would be somewhat the equivalent of two PhDs by the age of 21. I don't actually know how he came to that conclusion, but there is no question that Paul understood Judaism inside and out. He took a harder stance than his own teacher did. Because remember what Gamaliel said. Hey, look, if this is from God, it'll all work out. And if it's not, just like everything else, it'll fall away. Paul didn't seem to see it that way. He considered them so much a threat. He considered the Church of Jesus Christ to be such a threat that he went out and arrested and persecuted the church. He was there at the execution, the martyrdom of Stephen. That's the author of this epistle. But now, he's a servant of Christ Jesus. A servant. It's a common enough statement for Paul. He mentions it a few times. Most of the time, he calls himself an apostle, but here he combines them. He's a servant and an apostle. The word servant, you may notice you have a footnote that it comes from the Greek word doulos, which is all well and good, and that is certainly true, but the word is frequently translated as bondservant or slave. Paul has now become a servant, a bondservant, a slave of Christ Jesus. His entire life is now devoted to Christ. The one who persecuted the church, whom Christ himself said was persecuting himself, is now a slave to Christ. Slave or bondservant. Slaves, of course, require submission to their master in all things. And of course, God himself, the Lord Jesus Christ, he is the ultimate master. Now, of course, in our culture, due to the baggage that is sometimes equated with slavery, servant is not a bad translation. Don't think that just simply because you see the word servant there instead of slave or bondservant, that automatically they're just trying to be gentle and politically correct. There may be some truth to that, but servant is a legitimate translation. He is a servant of Christ. Paul's one master is Christ. He belongs to Christ. He serves Christ. It is a strong statement to make. He is a slave of Christ Jesus, and he's telling this to the church that is situated in the capital of the Roman Empire. That he's a slave. He's a Roman citizen, and he's calling himself a slave. A slave of Christ Jesus. This concept of being a slave or a bondservant of God, of Christ Jesus, is something that will become prominent in chapter 6. We've got a ways to go before we get there. But that is a huge arguing point that Paul makes. We're set free from the bondage of sin. We're no longer slaves to sin. But he goes on to say what freedom from sin means that we are now slaves of God and slaves of righteousness. So when people say to you, do you believe in slavery? Well, yes, I do. I'm slave to Christ. I belong to him, body and soul. I serve the Lord Jesus Christ. But he's not just a servant. He's called to be an apostle. Now, the words in the ESV called to be, the to be is not actually there in the Greek. So it could be, it's provided, and it's a perfectly legitimate translation, but it also could be translated this way: Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, a called apostle. That's a perfectly legitimate use as well. Implied here is that this call came from Christ himself. And of course, we know that from reading the account in the book of Acts. We're on the road to Damascus. He saw Christ. People frequently use the expression that he was knocked from his horse. Well, there's no indication that he had a horse. It's become so much a part of our language that I know I say it too. So I'm not like, I include myself in laughing at and chuckling at that. He was not knocked from a horse. There's no indication he was on a horse. But he certainly was knocked down when he saw Christ. He had a vision of Christ. And that vision completely changed him. And those of us who can remember when we became Christians have that time where we came, as it were, face to face with Christ. And our life was completely changed. That's the transforming work of the gospel that we'll see scattered all throughout this epistle. To transform a Pharisaical Jew in every possible sense and meaning of that into a servant of Christ Jesus. Who else but Christ Jesus could bring about such a transformation? Called to be an apostle. The word apostle itself, it comes from a Greek word meaning to send. And there's actually two different Greek words that are usually used to describe the idea of sending. This word, where we get apostle from, usually is used to describe the sending of people. The other word is usually the sending of stuff. That's not an absolute rule. So you may find it, you have a concordance, and you may find those mixed up from place to place. But nevertheless, generally, this word apostle comes from that same root meaning to send, which is usually described as of people. We have examples of those who are called apostles in the Bible who are not apostles with a capital A. For instance, Epaphroditus. In the book of Philippians, he was sent by the church. He's listed as an apostle, but he's not apostle with a capital A. That will have some bearing when we get to chapter 16. But nonetheless, there is something to this. To be an apostle with a capital A means that you had to have been directly appointed by Christ, to have seen Christ. Called by Christ himself. This happened on the road to Damascus to the Apostle Paul. He, at that point, became Christ's apostle, though it was a number of years before he was sent himself. The apostles are themselves uniquely tasked and uniquely equipped. They are tasked and equipped in such a way that that is a gift and a calling that no longer exists today. There are no apostles. So when you see clips on YouTube or TikTok or whatever social media you use, an apostle so-and-so, swipe. Don't even waste your time. There are no apostles today. It was a one-time office. But notice that he is a servant of Christ. He's an apostle, called an apostle, but he is set apart for the gospel of God. He goes even further. He describes the purpose for which he was called. He was set apart for the gospel. set apart for the gospel of God. Now, the word here, set apart, I thought, you know, as I'm reading this in English, my first thought was it's related to the word sanctify, the Greek word that's equivalent to the Hebrew word that has at its root the idea of being holy. Well, it's actually a different word. He's set apart. It's a perfectly legitimate translation, and it's a fine translation, but it's not the same word that we see sanctified. But he is set apart for the gospel of God. The word, of course, for gospel is where we get our word evangelism. It's really, evangelism is almost a complete transliteration of the Greek word. The word gospel in and of itself is not necessarily a Christian word. It just means good news or glad tidings. We see this in Greek literature. But when it comes to the gospel of Jesus Christ, there is no greater news. He is a servant of Christ. He is called to be an apostle, or a called apostle, because of the gospel, set apart for the gospel. Now, even this prepositional phrase here that's really small, the gospel of God, even this, commentators will differ on exactly what's being described here. What exactly does it mean? And it makes a Greek student cringe to try to understand the exact usage that Paul intends. It could be simply possessive in that the gospel belongs to God. Well, that's certainly true. It's his good news. It's his gospel. It could be describing the content. That is, it's a gospel about God. That's also true. But it also could be describing the source. That is, it is a gospel that comes from God. We can't be overly dogmatic, but given the overarching theme that we see, particularly as we think about the righteousness of God, that Martin Luther came to the epiphany to realize that that is something that comes from God, that we recognize that all of salvation, the gospel itself, comes from God himself. Yes, it's about God. Yes, it belongs to God, but it is a gospel that solely and completely comes from him. And as a result, that sets the stage for all of us to recognize that all of salvation is from him. It's all from him, from beginning to end. The gospel comes from God. Salvation comes from God. It's found in Jesus Christ, who himself came from God. All of it is from God. And Christ's servant in proclaiming the gospel is none other than the Apostle Paul, set apart for the sake of the gospel. And my friends, you and I are not going to be apostles. If you ever hear me call myself an apostle with a capital A, bring me before a presbytery. The apostles are done. There are some similar tasks that ministers of the gospel have. And it's simply this. They are ministers of word and sacrament. They preach and they rightly administer the sacraments. They do not heal. They do not perform miracles. But we share the good news of Jesus Christ. The good news that comes from God on high. Those glad tidings about Jesus Christ, who he is, and what he came to do. In that sense, you and I are Christ's servants as well. We have the responsibility to recognize the gospel. We have the responsibility to share the gospel, to recognize that we ourselves are servants, bondservants, slaves of Jesus Christ. He bought us. He redeemed us. We are now his. and what a privilege it is. The Apostle Paul is not dragging his feet here. As we'll see, this is something he rejoices in. He is Christ's servant. And for all of us, do you regard yourself as Christ's servant, called to serve him in the church and in the world? Do you see yourself as one who belongs to Christ, who is a slave to righteousness, a slave to him, that he is your master, and you will do whatever he bids? That's Christ's servant. Well, this brings us to our second point, Christ's scripture. Again, verses 1 and 2. Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God, which he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures. Now, verse 2 is actually the first of two modifiers to the gospel of God. The second one is in verse 3 concerning his son. So the gospel concerns his son. We'll look at that next week. But here, this first modifier of the gospel, it is a gospel which he promised beforehand. He promised beforehand. The two words in English, promise beforehand, it's actually a single compound word in the Greek. And it's a perfectly legitimate translation. Promised beforehand. We're all familiar with promises. And we try to keep our promises. And some people are hesitant to make promises because they're worried they'll break their promise. But the gospel is promised beforehand. It's nothing new. Paul is not actually giving to the Church of Rome new information. It's new to them, to be sure. But the content itself is nothing new. Just by way of a simple example, when you as a child learned that 2 plus 2 equals 4, and you understood it, and you figured that out, it was new to you, but it was always true. So it is with the gospel. When sinners are confronted with the gospel, they're confronted with their sin and they come to Jesus Christ, it is brand new to them, but it is itself, the content, nothing new. It was promised beforehand. Now, another thing to keep in mind is that there are places where we see the word promise, especially in the New Testament, but we see the word promise, and the context makes it clear that what's being described is covenant. Now, it's hard to definitively say that that's what Paul has in mind here, but there is a covenant way of thinking scattered throughout this epistle. References to Abraham, the reality of the one sin in Adam, bringing death to all mankind, bringing condemnation to all mankind, and the one act of obedience of Christ, meaning salvation for all who believe. That's all covenantal language. The gospel is a result of the covenant. And so it is not impossible that Paul here, in referring to what was promised beforehand, is referring to that which is covenanted. And we see the seed of this as far back as Genesis 3, where the initiation of the covenant of grace, the promised seed of the woman that would crush the head of the serpent. Now you look at our text here in Romans 1 verse 2, which he promised through his prophets. And you're thinking, well, that was in the Torah. That wasn't in the prophets. But oftentimes in the Bible, as we see, the prophets are more than just what we consider Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Daniel, etc. Moses is called a prophet. Samuel is called a prophet. David is called a prophet. But we also know that Paul elsewhere in his letter to the Galatians, which more than likely he wrote before Romans, he said to the Galatians that the gospel was preached to Abraham. Promised beforehand. So when Paul says here the prophets, it's all the revelation of God. All of it. It's the part put for the whole of Scripture up to that point. The gospel itself, the content, the good news, the promise, the covenant is actually nothing new. And Paul is a messenger of this gospel. And so why we in today's day and age, and I don't mean you and me, so I don't think anybody does this, but why professing Christians in today's day and age, we need to do something with the gospel to make it new and fresh, to make it new and relevant to the culture we're in. We need something else. No, we don't. It's the same gospel. Clearly, Paul had a greater understanding. Clearly, those of us on this side of the cross have a greater understanding. But the substance of the gospel has always been the same. Trust in the promised Messiah, and you will be saved. Trust in God, and He will forgive you of your sins. This gospel was promised beforehand. It was proclaimed, as I mentioned, long ago. It was first promised in Genesis 3. We see it again in Genesis 8 and 9. We see it again in Genesis 12 and 15 and 17. We see it at Sinai. Yes, we see the gospel at Sinai. And all throughout Scripture. And see, that's what Paul says here. Promised beforehand through his prophets in Holy Scripture. You see, all of this is inscripturated in his word. We are now at a point in time, in redemptive history, where the canon of Scripture is closed. There is no more Scripture to be had. But even Paul, writing to the Romans, is reminding them that this gospel that he preaches was promised beforehand, and they can find it in the prophecies found in Scripture. That's why it is imperative that ministers of the Word preach from the Word. Not from movies, not from popular books, but from the Word. The gospel is here. And to even emphasize this point, Paul calls Scriptures holy. Scriptures are holy. You see, the word there for Scriptures, it's another one of those generic common Greek words. It just means writing. That's all it means. It has uses elsewhere and other contexts. But these are not just any writings. They're sacred writings. Holy, sanctified, holy, sacred writings that contain the very gospel of Jesus Christ. That should help us in our approach to Scripture. As you open up God's Word each and every day, please open it up each and every day. What you are opening before your eyes is sacred. It is sacred. It is holy. And the Spirit uses it to sanctify you. It contains the good news. Now, you've heard me before mention, we understand that not every single jot and tittle in and of itself is itself a gospel message. But the entirety of Scripture as a whole is pointing to Christ, points to salvation in Him, points to the good news. Scripture is redemptive revelation. That's why we need it. From beginning to end, it is redemptive revelation. It is good news. Even those passages that speak of judgment and warning against sin, and we see the consequences of sin. We see the destruction that sin causes and the punishment that it brings because we serve a holy God. Yet even the warnings of judgment are themselves gracious, that they might turn us from our sin, that we would become slaves to Christ. This is redemptive revelation. You see, Scripture, not just the book of Romans, but all of Scripture is the gospel. When you open up the pages of Holy Writ, do you find good news? Do you recognize that this book is holy and sacred and contains within it the way of salvation? Do you recognize that when you look at various passages in Scripture that actually do explicitly speak of the gospel, that it is a gospel that in and of itself is not new, but what you experience of the mercies of that gospel is new? They are new every morning, right? We know the expression in the song. They are new every morning. His mercies. It's the same mercy experienced in new ways. The gospel of Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow, but we experience it all in new and fresh ways. That's what's new. That's what's fresh, is our experience of the same gospel of Jesus Christ. And because His grace is infinite, those new and fresh experiences of His grace are inexhaustible. We have an apostle, a servant of Jesus Christ. His task is to bring the gospel forth. This is the task of the Church of Jesus Christ. This gospel that we are set apart for. This should all give us a sense of urgency, as it did the Apostle Paul. It is good news that has been promised from beforehand. It is our job to take this gospel to the world. It is our job to remember this gospel. It is our responsibility to live this gospel. As we make our way through this wonderful epistle, we're going to talk about the gospel proper. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. But we're also going to talk about the effects of the gospel. How the gospel transforms our lives and we live out of that transforming power of the gospel. That the gospel and the content of the gospel transforms us in such a way that we are now enabled to live in accordance to His word. This is the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's what the epistle to the Romans is all about. This is your gospel, your good news that comes from God on high. It's about God. He owns it, but it's from Him. Take it to others and point to the good news of Jesus Christ. This is what this epistle's about. Is it any wonder, then, that it becomes a favorite of so many theologians? Isn't it a wonder, then, to help us to see that the gospel is so rich, so simple, yes, but also so rich and so deep? As we go through Romans, may all of us see the depth and the richness of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's pray. Our great God and Father in heaven, how we rejoice at what your word teaches us. We thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ, his gospel, the reality that he came and died for sinners such as ourselves. That this gospel, the very content of the gospel, is itself nothing new, but that which was promised beforehand through the prophets and even in the garden after the fall. Lord, help us to remain faithful and true to this gospel, that we would not seek to add to the gospel, but simply to rely upon it and to rely upon our Lord Jesus Christ. We pray all this in his name. Amen.